Good afternoon. Welcome to Shankara Academy of Visions, Learning from the Master Series. Today we have Nikita, who is a bachelor from Shankara College of Optometry and master's from Chitkara University. Nikita has a special interest in vision therapy and teaches and practices vision therapy in Shankara Eye Hospital. Nikita will be talking about diagnosing and managing vergence anomalies. Over to you, Nikita.
Thank you so much, sir. Good afternoon, everyone. Today, I'll be taking you through how to diagnose and manage vergence anomalies. But before we go into this, let's see what is vergence and why this topic is important. If you see vergence, it is simultaneous eye movements moving inward or outward, that is convergence or divergence. When there is an inability to perform this task, then it leads to vergence anomaly or vergence disorder. A study done by Scheinman in 1996 says that prevalence of vergence anomalies or binocular vision disorders is more as compared to refractive error. Now, this brings to your notice why this topic is important. There are many supporting articles to this, which says convergence insufficiency is more prevalent among all the binocular vision disorders. Again, convergence insufficiency has a greater impact on academic performance and classroom environment for any school-going child. Let us now apply this on in our day-to-day lives and see, not only in a classroom environment or a learning ability, but also in any near vision task or near activities, it is going to have an effect. So a timely diagnosis and appropriate management is very important to improve the quality of life. The various vergence dysfunctions are convergence insufficiency, convergence excess, divergence insufficiency, divergence excess, fusional vergence dysfunction, basic esophoria, and basic exophoria. Now, when we go into the symptoms of the patients, the patients can be symptomatic or asymptomatic. Now, symptomatic and asymptomatic doesn't mean that the condition is very severe or mild. It can also be because their pain threshold is low or high. When it comes to asymptomatic patients, it is also because when they are suppressing either of the eyes or when there is a vergence dysfunction, they tend to close one eye in order to reduce the demand of vergence. So even in these conditions, patients can be asymptomatic. One thing which we have to remember is in these conditions, symptoms will increase with prolonged near work, especially when it comes with IT professionals or those who are working in whose work entails a lot of near activities. What happens is by the end of the day, the symptoms will increase. If you see the various symptoms, patients who has vergence dysfunction will have various symptoms, like they'll have asthenopic symptoms. They can come with a complaint of headache. They can come with a complaint of blurring of vision and double vision sometimes. And they can have poor concentration. So whenever they tend to do any near activities, they'll have poor concentration or they lose interest very easily in any reading task or anything. And in cases like convergence insufficiency, what happens is they tend to have fatigue. So with the prolonged near work, they tend to have fatigue and sleeping tendencies will be there. In severe cases, the patients can even have mild ocular redness and tearing. There are many symptom-based questionnaires, one among which was shown by Mr. Divakar Rao yesterday's session. So questionnaires developed by College of Optometrists in Vision Development, Convergence Insufficiency Symptom Survey, Visual Quality Scale, and by CITT. There are many questionnaires, but they are only a screening tool. We just get to know if the patient is having a binocular vision disorder or not. We may not be able to diagnose exactly what is a vergence dysfunction in that patient. So symptom-based questionnaires can be ruled out. But one thing in this is asymptomatic patients will not get diagnosed in this thing. So if a patient visits your clinic and says that he has the above mentioned symptoms like headache, asthenopic symptoms or something, and if you have done a slit lamp examination and if the anterior segment is within normal limit, and even in refractive error, when you do refraction, you don't see any significant power, do not get confused or do not worry about what has to be done. You can always refer the patient for a binocular vision assessment, which helps you in further management of the patient. Binocular vision assessment was explained in detail by Mr. Divakar Rao in yesterday's session. So I'm not going to go into the binocular vision assessment, but let's see how to diagnose a Wurgens dysfunction. When it comes to diagnosis of Wurgens dysfunction, the main thing you see is fovea. Okay, so here we are going to see when the fovea is not within the normal limit. When the fovea is not within the normal limit, you first see what is the type and amount of fovea at distance and near. So once you see that, try to correlate it with the direct test and the indirect test. If you see the direct test, it gives you a direct measurement of the Wurgens, like near point of convergence, fusional Wurgens, that is your negative and positive fusional Wurgens, and your Wurgens facility. If you go into the indirect test, you will have indirect measures of Wurgens like relative accommodation, that is your positive and negative relative accommodation, monocular estimation method, and binocular accommodative facility. I repeat, first you see what is the type and amount of fovea at distance and near, then try to correlate it with the direct and the indirect test. So when you see the fovea as abnormal at distance and near, in cases where you see exophoria at distance and near, so what you have to do is, if the exophoria is more at distance the exophoria is more, then it is divergence excess. If the exophoria is equal at distance and near, that is the magnitude of the or the amount of fovea, exophoria at distance and near is less than 5 prism diopter difference, then it is basic exophoria. If the exophoria is more at near, patient will not be able to converge. Exophoria is more at near, then it is convergence insufficiency. So similar thing applies to your esophoria also. If your esophoria is more at distance, patient will not be able to diverge. So more at distance, so it is divergence insufficiency. If the esophoria is equal at distance and near with less than 5 prism diopter magnitude, then it is basic esophoria. If the esophoria is more at near, then it is convergence excess. Now, when your fovea is normal at distance and near, but still the patient has the above mentioned symptoms or complaints of blurring vision or headache or whatever, in that condition, try to look into other conditions like fusional Wurgens dysfunction. So look for fusional Wurgens dysfunction. I'll explain about fusional Wurgens dysfunction in the further slides. Look for any accommodative disorders. See, the Wurgens could be fine. Maybe the accommodation is having a problem. So you try to look into the accommodative parameters and see if it is okay or not. And also look for if there is any latent hyperopia. You can refer for a cycloplegic refraction and look for any latent hyperopia. So we'll start with the case analysis so you'll have a better understanding about the diagnosis. There was a 27-year-old male who visited our clinic, who was an IT professional. He came with a complaint of bitemporal headache since 6 to 8 months. He had a headache immediately after 15 to 20 minutes of computer work. His headache decreased whenever he took a break from the computer work. He did not have any nausea or vomiting along with this headache. There was no specific ocular or general health history. The patient was not under any medication. He was not aware of any allergies. So when we checked his present glass prescription and the refraction part, his present glass prescription had only cylindrical powers in right eye and left eye. When we did a refraction, we got a plano in right eye and the cylinder was the same in left eye as with his glasses. The vision was within normal limit. So he had 6-6 vision at near and N6 vision at near. If you see the slit lamp examination, his anterior segment was within normal limit in both the eyes. So fundus was also normal in both the eyes. Before we did the dilated fundus evaluation, the patient was referred for binocular vision assessment. So let's see what was a binocular vision assessment. So in binocular vision assessment, the sensory status was good. Patient had fusion at both distance and near. Stereopsis was good. If you see the MOTA test, so the MOTA test, extraocular motility was full, free and painless in both the eyes. Now look into the fovea. So try to look into the fovea and try to correlate it with the direct and the indirect test. So cover test showed exophoria at distance and near. Prism bar cover test had 2 prism basin at distance and 10 prism basin at near. AC by ratio was within normal limit. If you see the NPC, NPC with accommodative target and with red filter was receding. Both the values were receding. So your amplitude of the patient's amplitude of accommodation was okay in the monocularly. Binocularly, it was slightly towards the excess side. NRA, the NRA value was plus 1.75 diopter and PRA was minus 2.75 diopter. MEM had a lead of accommodation. In both the eyes, MEM was showing a lead. NFE at distance and near was within normal limit. PFE at distance and near were reduced. So if you see here, in PFE, there is a break at 6 prisms and at distance, and at near, there is a break at 8 prisms. So this is very poor. Accommodative facility monocularly was better. It was slightly towards a borderline. It was slightly reduced. So, and binocularly, it was only 3 cycles per minute, and there was a difficulty with plus. So we all know that binocularly plus is to assess convergence and binocularly minus is to assess divergence. So try to keep that in your mind, and then you can, it will be easy for you to diagnose. Virgin's facility had 3 cycles per minute with a difficulty with base out. Base out is for convergence and base in is for divergence. So let's see what is the diagnosis. So before we go into the diagnosis, though yesterday Divakar sir had mentioned about the normative values, quickly I would like to take you through the normative values so it becomes a revision for you. So if you see here, at distance exophoria, it should be around 1 exophoria, and at near 3 exophoria, plus or minus 3, that is from ortho to or 0 to 6 prisms of exophoria is fine. NPC had has a normative value of 3 centimeter break and 5 centimeter recovery, plus or minus 5. So up to like 8 centimeter break and 10 centimeter recovery is fine. So if you see NFV, then NFV had a break at 7. So should have a break at around 7 prisms. If you see NFV at near, PFE at distance and near, the break should be approximately around at least 20 prisms. You see here, it should be at least around 20 prisms. Virgin's facility, the patient should be, or anybody should be having at least 8 cycles per minute. NRA plus 2.50 diopter and PRA minus 2.50 diopter. MEM, everyone will be having a lag of accommodation. So a normal lag of around plus 0.50 diopter to plus 0.75 diopter would be acceptable. Binocular accommodative facility of 8 cycles per minute would be good. So if you see here, first you look into the near, the foreas. So if you see here, the near fovea, the near exophoria is more. So when exophoria is more at near, it is convergence insufficiency. Now try to correlate it with the direct test. Your direct test are your NPC. So NPC both with accommodative and non-accommodative target is receding. The next is your Virgin's facility. So Virgin's facility shows 3 cycles per minute. So 3 cycles per minute, and there is a difficulty with base out. Look into the PFE value, positive fusional Virgin's. At both distance and near, it is reduced. Now again, try to correlate it with the indirect test. That is your negative relative accommodation, which is plus 1.75 diopter. Look into the MEM, it's going into lead of accommodation. And binocular accommodative facility is 3 cycles per minute. So if you see the direct test, everything is reduced with base out. And if you see the indirect test, everything is reduced with binocularly plus lens. So this drives you to the thing that convergence parameters are poor. So this is a case of convergence insufficiency. So if you see the diagnostic criteria for exophoria, the exophoria, if it is more at near, then it is convergence insufficiency. If you see in the direct test of convergence insufficiency, NPC will be receding. PFE value, that is your convergence parameter, will be less. Convergence fusional Virgin's will be less. Your Virgin's facility will have a difficulty with base out, and AC by A ratio will be low. So in convergence insufficiency or divergence insufficiency, the AC by A ratio will be low. if you see in any excess of versions, convergence excess or divergence excess, AC by A ratio will be high. Coming to the indirect test, if you see in MEM, you will have a reflex reaction from the brain, which causes a lead of accommodation, a reflex reaction to convergence insufficiency. So this leads to a lead of accommodation, and you're binocularly testing the plus lenses, that is your NRA, negative relative accommodation, will be less, and binocular accommodative facility, the patient will have a difficulty with plus. The same thing will apply for your divergence excess and basic exophoria as well. Only thing is that in divergence excess, NPC may or may not get affected. In most of the cases, it will not get affected. In some cases, yes, even the in extreme cases, even the convergence can get affected. If you see in the basic exophoria, so in basic exophoria, it's a tonic version. So NPC and AC by ratio will not be affected here. Otherwise, everything will be similar to your convergence insufficiency. So let's try and work up one more case so it becomes easy for you. So there was an other patient who was 17-year-old male. He was a 12th standard student. So he came with a complaint of asthenopic symptoms associated with short periods of reading. So he said that he used to feel better after taking a small nap, though the asthenopic symptoms used to recur as he is exposed to reading once again. He was not using any glasses or contact lenses. His ocular and general health history was perfectly fine. He was not under any medication. So when we did his visual acuity assessment, he had a vision of 6/6 at distance and N6 at near. His dry and wet refraction both showed a very small power. It was not clinically significant power. So coming to the fovea, now try to look into the fovea and then you can correlate it with the direct and the indirect test. So fovea showed orthophorea at distance and exophorea at near. Prism bar cover test showed orthophorea at distance and two prisms of exophorea at near. AC by ratio was within normal limit. Amplitude of accommodation was okay. It was within the normal limit, both monocularly and binocularly. NPC had a break at 5 cm and recovery at 8 cm, and it was not receding. Now look into the NFE and PFE value. NFE and PFE value at both distance and near, if you see, everything has an early break. That is, the values are showing a poor convergence and divergence. If you see the NRA has plus 1.50 diopter, PRA has minus 1 diopter sphere. Monocular accommodative facility was perfectly fine, but when you see the binocular accommodative facility, it had only 4 cycles per minute, where the patient had difficulty with plus and minus. So both, again here, both convergence and divergence is having a problem. Vergence facility, the patient was poor. He was having only 2 cycles per minute with a difficulty with both base in and base out. That is, base in is for divergence and base out for convergence. So let's see the diagnosis. So as said, all the base in and base out parameter and binocularly all the plus and minus lenses were failed. So this is called fusional vergence dysfunction. In fusional vergence dysfunction, both convergence and divergence is affected. So what happens is binocularly patient will have difficulty with even plus lens and minus lens, but when you see monocularly, patient will not have any issues. So accommodation will be perfectly fine. Look into the fovea. Fovea will be perfectly fine, but when you see the convergence and divergence parameters, everything will be affected. Even your NPC also will be fine, but when it comes to the range and velocity of vergence, fusional vergence, it will be down. So as said, going to the diagnostic criteria, we have all the base in, base out, and binocularly plus and minus will be poor, whereas your fovea will be normal. So there's another case, you're not yet done. So let's work up one more case and then we'll move on with the management. So there was a 27-year-old female. She was working as a teacher. So she came with complaint of recent episodes of losing interest when reading, and she had pain in and around the eyes after prolonged near work. So she was also adding that she felt better whenever she takes a break from the near work. She was not using glasses for distance or near or anything. She did not have any refractive error according to her knowledge. So her ocular and systemic illness was nil. She did not have any problem. She was not under any medication. Her vision was 6-6 at distance and N6 at near at around 40 centimeter. So subjective refraction showed a planar value. Now look into the fovea. So fovea showed exophorea at distance and esophorea at near. So there is an esophorea at near, wherein our normative value was from 0 to 3, 6 prism exophorea. Prism bar cover test showed 2 prisms basin at distance and 4 prism base out at near. AC by A ratio was 8:1. Amplitude of accommodation both monocularly and binocularly were within normal limit. NPC was having a break at 2 cm, which is very closer to the eyes, and a recovery at 3 cm. NFE value was having a poor recovery. It was reduced, so it had a poor recovery. NFE is for divergence. When you see the PFE, PFE was more than normal. Usually we expect a break at around 20 prisms, but here it is breaking at 30 prism diopter. NRA was plus 2.50 diopter. PRA was minus 0.50 diopter. Monocular accommodative facility was 8 cycles per minute. Binocular accommodative facility had only 2 cycles per minute, and the patient had difficulty with minus. So binocularly, patient is having a difficulty with minus. And Virgin's facility had a difficulty with basin, and patient had 0 cycles per minute. In fact, the patient was failing with basin. Patient couldn't make it single at all. So now try to look into the fovea, try to correlate it with the direct test and the indirect test. I hope most of you would have diagnosed the case, but let's go into the diagnosis. So if you see here, there is an esophorea more at distance, or distance fovea is normal, but near fovea has an esophorea. So this looks like a convergence excess case, but try to correlate it with the direct test. So NPC is too much. It is breaking at 2 cm, very closer to the eyes. Because of convergence excess, your NFE values are affected, whereas PFE is more than normal and your NFE values are affected. If you see here, and even binocular accommodative facility and Virgin's facility, all the divergence parameters are affected. Now correlate it with your fovea. So this is a convergence excess case. And if you see the AC by A ratio, AC by A ratio shows a 8:1. So it shows 8:1 ratio. So it is slightly excess. So in convergence excess and divergence excess, you will have a high AC by A ratio. So this is a convergence excess case. Going into the diagnostic criteria for esophorea, if you see, if the esophorea is more at near, then it is convergence excess. So what happens here is, in the direct test, NPC will be more than normal, NFE will be affected, Virgin's facility will show a difficulty with base in, AC by A ratio will be high. Indirect test, MEM will show a lag of accommodation. As said in convergence insufficiency, in convergence excess also, you will have a reflex reaction from the brain to excess of Virgin's, and it will show a lag of accommodation. PRA will be reduced, and binocular accommodative facility, patient will have difficulty with minus. So same thing is going to apply for your divergence insufficiency and basic esophorea. As said with the previous diagnostic criteria for exophorea, in divergence insufficiency, your NPC will not be affected and your MEM will not be affected. But if you see in basic esophorea, the NPC and the AC by A ratio will not be affected. Otherwise, every parameters will be similar to your convergence excess. It is with the amount of fovea at distance and near, you'll get an idea if it is convergence excess or divergence insufficiency or basic esophorea. So now we are done with the diagnosis. I hope everybody would have got some idea about how to diagnose a case. Let's see how do we manage a case with divergence or vergence anomaly. So I'm not going to go in deep about the procedures of each therapy, but I'm just going to tell at what stage what therapy can be given. So usually we can manage the conditions with lenses, prisms, and vision therapy. Doesn't mean that you need a very costly equipments to manage vergence anomalies or binocular vision disorders. You can always you always have options of lenses and prisms also here. So with vision therapy, when we work, we usually work with anaglyphs and Polaroids, septums and apertures, stereoscopes, paper, other tasks which can be made with paper, pencil, or other miscellaneous task. So if you see in a convergence insufficiency, this is about what are the primary and the secondary mode of treatment for various vergence disorders. See, I can start with the vergence, fusional vergence dysfunction, the last option, fusional vergence dysfunction. If you see in fusional vergence dysfunction, as I told you, patient is going to fail with base in, base out, and binocularly patient will have difficulty with plus and minus also. So added lenses or relieving prisms is not going to help in this condition. The only option for fusional vergence dysfunction is vision therapy. You will have to do a vision therapy or advise vision therapy in fusional vergence dysfunction cases. Now let's start with convergence insufficiency. In convergence insufficiency, the primary treatment is vision therapy, and the secondary treatment is you can give relieving prisms. For convergence, a relieving prism is base in prism. Okay, so for convergence insufficiency, when the patient is having an insufficient convergence, relieving prism would be base in prism. When we go to convergence excess, the only anomaly where the primary treatment is added lens is convergence excess. So you can give added lenses in cases like convergence excess. And going to divergence insufficiency, you can treat a divergence insufficiency and basic esophoria in similar manner. So for divergence insufficiency and basic esophoria, the primary treatment would be base out prism, that is relieving prisms. That is, if for relieving prism for divergence insufficiency or basic esophoria is base out prism. Secondary treatment, you can give vision therapy. For basic esophoria, you have other options also, like you can give added lenses. Just like in convergence excess case, in basic esophoria, you can give even added lenses. Moving on to divergence excess can be treated similarly to the basic exophoria. So for divergence excess and basic exophoria, the primary treatment is vision therapy. The secondary treatment is added lenses. That is, we give added minus lenses for distance. So when we give, these are relieving lenses for divergence excess or basic exophoria. So what happens is when we give a minus lens for distance, and when the patient is using the same minus lenses for near, the patient, it can cause an extra demand or over demand for accommodation, which in turn can cause an impact on the convergence also. In order to avoid this, you can either ask the patient to remove the glasses and work without the minus lenses for near, or you can give added plus lenses at near, like a bifocals you can give, like where it is a minus for distance and a plus for near, like that also it can be given. Or another option for basic exophoria is relieving prism, that is your basin prisms. So I'll quickly go take you through the vergence various vision therapies available. So at what stage what therapy can be given? So I'll start with first case, that is convergence insufficiency. If you see in convergence insufficiency, the first therapy what you can start with, or what would be a good start, is with the Brock string. Now I prefer Brock string over other therapies which entails a lot of central fusion, because this works on the principle of physiological diplopia, and it entails a lot of peripheral awareness and peripheral fusion as compared to other therapies which entails a lot of central fusion to begin with, I'm saying. So if you see here, if you are going to focus at a near beat or a far beat, except that beat, all other beats are appearing double. So this is physiological diplopia. So you always ask the patient to look at one beat, maintain the, so first the patient has to get the physiological diplopia and then try to maintain the physiological diplopia, and then you move on to the next beat and the next beat like that. So this is basically done to normalize your near point of convergence. So if you want to increase or decrease the difficulty, suppose if it is very difficult for a person to start with, then you can start with larger sized beats, a big sized beats, and then slowly reduce the size of the beats. The next therapy is your vectorgram and tranaglyphs. See, if you see, the vectorgrams and tranaglyphs are almost the same, okay? It works in the same manner. But what is different here is in tranaglyphs, what happens is you're using a red and green target. So what happens is there is inequality in the retinal illuminance between both the eyes. So this becomes hard for a person to get the fusion and to maintain the fusion also. So according to many studies and from my personal experience also, patients, it will be very difficult for patient to get fusion and maintain the fusion with a tranaglyph as compared to vectorgram. That's why we always start with vectorgram, improve the vergence to some extent, and then slowly you can move on to the tranaglyphs part. So in vectorgrams, you use Polaroid glasses. Both vectorgram and tranaglyphs are to improve the fusional vergence amplitude, that is your negative and positive fusional vergence, and also to improve the velocity of fusional vergence. So how do we get the convergence and vergence demand? Here is, you, there are two slides. So in vectorgram and in your tranaglyph, there are two slides. So horizontal separation of these slides will help you in creating a convergence and divergence demand. So this is done at around 40 centimeter. And as I told you, we always move from peripheral targets to central target, peripheral fusion to central fusion. So when you want to, when the patient is done at least around 20 to 25 prisms of convergence and 10 to 15 prisms of divergence, then the next step is, so this is almost around normal levels, okay? So this is like around the end points of vectorgram and tranaglyphs. So when the patient is able to do till here, then the next step is you break the fusion. So how do you break the fusion? You either close one eye or ask the patient to look at far. So you ask to look at far or close one eye and then break the fusion, and then ask the patient to look back into the target. And as soon as the patient looks into the target, the patient should be able to regain the fusion immediately. So this is like the next step of your therapies in vectorgram and tranaglyphs. In tranaglyphs, you have variable and non-variable tranaglyphs. So as said, first you come with the vectorgram, then you move to variable tranaglyphs. Then next you move on to the non-variable tranaglyphs. Why? Because in non-variable tranaglyphs, the demand of vergence doesn't start with zero. As in, like, if you see in your variable tranaglyphs, the demand starts from zero, then slowly you can move on to two prisms, four prisms, six prisms, like that. But that is not the case with non-variable tranaglyphs. What happens here is, there is already a demand of vergence, a convergence or divergence there. So the patient should fuse the first image, then jump to the next image, like that the patient should be going. So convergence and divergence demand, as said, it is with the horizontal separation between the two targets. In non-variable tranaglyphs, there will be already a disparity there. You can also use computerized therapies, where computerized therapies you can club along with your vectorgram therapy, and so like hand in hand, you can take it simultaneously. So computerized therapies will be working on random dot stereogram. So it will be working on fusion, your stereopsis, your fusional range, your velocity of fusion, jump tuction. There are so many options in computerized therapies. So computerized therapies are also very effective in improving the vergence anomalies. So there's something called as septums and aperture, as I told you earlier. So we also work with septums and apertures. So like aperture ruler and your Bernalloscope. So if you see in aperture ruler and Bernalloscope, the demand is created with single aperture and double aperture and aperture ruler. So single aperture is for convergence and double aperture for divergence. So this is using the apertures, we create the convergence and the divergence demand. In Bernalloscopes, we have different targets, like different targets for convergence and divergence. So that is how we create the demand. So now the thing here is, here also the demand doesn't start at zero prisms. So if you're, if the patient is already having a Wurgen's anomaly, and if you're suddenly exposing them to a target which is already having a Wurgen's demand of some like 2.5 prisms or 15 prisms or 10 prisms, it will be very difficult for the person to fuse. So usually these therapies are given during the middle or by the end of the therapies. You can give these therapies of aperture ruler and burnelloscope. So here we have pictures of how aperture ruler and burnelloscopes can be done. There are some home-based therapies also, like your barrel cards, free space fusion cards, lifesaver card, and eccentric circles. These therapies also can be given for home-based purpose. Along with this, you can also give your Brock string therapy. You can give your computerized therapy. So home-based softwares can be given, which again works on the patient's convergence and divergence. So even these therapies can be considered for your home-based Wurgen's therapies. So going on to the second case, fusional Wurgen's dysfunction, I told you that only vision therapy is going to help in this condition. So here, base in, base out, plus, minus, everything is affected. So one thing which we have to remember whenever we give vision therapy is, see, when the person is having Wurgen's disorder, doesn't mean that you have to give only Wurgen's therapies. We should also give accommodative therapies where the patient can actually, you'll have to balance the parameters between accommodation and Wurgen's parameters. So in order to balance the parameters and the function, so what you have to do is you have to give both accommodative and Wurgen's therapies. So if you see in especially conditions like fusional Wurgen's dysfunction, you'll have to give both therapies with plus lenses and minus lenses. So with lenses and prisms, so which helps in accommodation and Wurgen's. Why? Because accommodation also has an impact or an effect on the Wurgen's. Indirectly, it affects Wurgen's also. So going to the third case, I told you that the only Wurgen's anomaly where the primary treatment is added lens is convergence excess. So we give added lenses in several ways, like we use NRA-PRA method, we use MEM method, and there is also another method, AC by A ratio method. But most commonly preferred and most commonly used is NRA and PRA method, and sometimes MEM method also. So I'll just explain you the how do you give added lenses with some examples. Like if you see NRA, if NRA is plus 2.50 diopters and PRA is minus 0.50 diopter, add NRA and PRA. Once you add NRA and PRA, divide it by 2, which is equal to plus 1 diopter. So you can give added lenses of plus 1 diopter. Or when it comes to MEM value, you will have to see what is patient's MEM. Subtract a normal MEM from the patient's MEM. So patient's MEM here was plus 1.50 diopter. Now subtract normal MEM. The normal MEM which we consider is 0.50 diopter. You subtract that from the patient's MEM, which is again plus 1 diopter. So added lenses of plus 1 diopter can be given. Alternative therapy for convergence excess is vision therapy. Vision therapy procedures, whichever I have explained you, are the procedures. You'll have to give the therapy based on what is the condition and what is the severity. One particular thing you have to remember in convergence excess is, because the convergence is excess, divergence is very poor. In this condition, at least during the initial part of the therapy, do not give any base out therapy. Don't touch the convergence part at all, at least during the initial part, because it will be very difficult to improve the divergence. So first you work on divergence, improve the divergence to some extent. Probably by the end of therapy or something, you can give a little amount of base out therapy or convergence therapy to balance the functions. Otherwise, in the beginning, if you're going to give convergence therapy, it will be very difficult to improve the divergence therapy. So first you focus on divergence, then you move on to the balancing part. So to summarize everything, if it's become too much for you, I'll just summarize whatever we have seen today. When it comes to diagnosis, First, you see what is the amount of urea, and then you try to correlate it with the direct and the indirect test. So as said, the direct test where your near point of convergence, your fusional vergence amplitude, and your vergence facility. Indirect test are something which indirectly measures vergence, like your negative and positive relative accommodation, binocular accommodative facility, and your MEM value. When it comes to management, we have options with lenses, prisms, and vision therapy. For fusional vergence dysfunction, you can do only vision therapy. The only vergence anomaly which uses added lenses as primary option is convergence excess. For all other vergence anomalies, you can take vision therapy, like your convergence insufficiency, divergence excess, basic exophoria. You can use vision therapy as a primary option. Still, I would like to conclude here saying that though we have seen all these therapy options and everything, patient's symptoms has to be considered as a main thing. So you treat each person as an individual case. Do not go theoretically like there is no hard and fast rule that yes, I have to do vision therapy for this patient. No, look into the patient's symptoms, look into the severity, see the patient's availability. If the patient cannot come for vision therapy, then you'll have to look for the alternate therapies. So treat each patient individually. These are my references. Thank you so much. I would like to thank Shankara Academy of Vision and Shankara Eye Hospital for this platform, and all my faculties, seniors, colleagues from Shankara College of Optometry. Thank you. A very big thank you to my mentor, Professor Aditya Goyal. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Nikita. That was a wonderful talk from you. I do see a few questions.
Okay,
I don't know the name of this person. He or she writes Optom Nerds.
Okay.
So we'll be happy to know the name. So there's a question from this person. Why there's lead of accommodation in convergence insufficiency patients?
Okay, so what happens in convergence insufficiency is there is a poor convergence. So we all know that MEM is done binocularly. In binocular condition, it is done, right? So what happens is when there is a convergence insufficiency, in order to compensate for that deficient or for that insufficient vergence, the brain is going to send a reflex reaction to it. So in the reflex reaction, what happens is it is going to increase the accommodation in order to compensate for the poor vergence there. So we get a lead of accommodation in convergence insufficiency and vice versa in convergence excess.
Thanks, Nikita. I think he goes about asking, is it because to compensate for exophoria apnea, the demand will be more in positive fusional vergence component, so that through the convergence accommodation crosslink, the accommodative response also tends to be more?
Okay. See, as said, thank you for this question, sir. So as
Do you
said,
want me to repeat that?
No, sir. It's okay. I got the question. So as you said, sir, yes, it is because of the excess exophoria at near. So what happens, what is happening because of exophoria is what we have to see. See, having a phoria at near or distance, it's not within normal limit. That is not my concern. My concern is what is getting affected because of that. Patient's convergence and divergence is getting affected because of that. So patient's quality of life is getting affected because of that. If you see here, patient's convergence is affected. When the convergence is affected, what happens is the brain is sending a reflex reaction in order to compensate a normal physiological thing which is happening there to compensate the insufficient vergence there. That is what is happening here.
He also wants to know why binocular amplitude of accommodation is not affected.
Binocular amplitude of accommodation is showing slightly towards the excess side, because though vergence is playing a role, mainly, especially the main thing which is acting here is your amplitude of accommodation. So when the amplitude of accommodation is basically not affected, so binocularly it is not causing much issue here, because though vergence is playing a very small role here, it is not affecting the binocular amplitude of accommodation.
He also wants to know the MEM value in the second case, that is a fusional vergence dysfunction case.
The MEM value in the second case was not very much affected. I can just go into the case. So MEM value, I'm sorry, it's not put here, but MEM value was not affected in this case. It was almost around plus 0.75 adapter in this case in both the eyes.
Thanks, Nikita. There's another statement. Binocular amplitude of accommodation will always be better than monocular amplitude of accommodation because of the involvement of convergence accommodation crosslink. Suppose if there's fusion dysfunction, then what happens?
So when there is fusion dysfunction, yes, it can be affected, but there is no hard and fast rule that in all the cases it has to be affected. So when the fusional dysfunction is there, based on whatever, suppose if convergence is affected, then you can have an accommodation excess to a reflex reaction to that can be there.
Okay. So will it affect the binocular accommodation?
When it comes to binocular accommodation, it will not be it. So patient can have some, see, when it comes binocularly, vergence is also playing there. So definitely, yes, it can get affected, especially when you're doing, when the patient is having, when it comes to the glass prescription, if you're going to give up plus lenses for convergence insufficiency, definitely the patient will have some problems with that. Sir, would you like to add on something to this?
No, you're fine.
Okay, sir.
Ms. Sumana Giri wants to know, first of all, she has complimented you on a beautiful presentation that you made.
Thank you, ma'am.
Patient having combined deficiency, these cases, how do you diagnose and manage? How do you diagnose these cases?
Okay, so when it comes to combined deficiencies, like if you have convergence insufficiency associated with accommodation excess, so this is a secondary effect, right? So first you see the primary thing, what is getting affected. And as I told you, you'll have to, the main, based on the fovea, you can get to know, like, if the problem is with the fovea, that is vergence, or if the problem is with the accommodation. And if you see the binocular parameters, if you see, especially in cases like monocular accommodative facility and binocular accommodative facility, when vergence is the primary thing, your binocular accommodative facility will be poorer than the monocular thing. Okay. And when it comes to diagnosis, the primary thing here that is affected is convergence insufficiency. You work for convergence insufficiency, and then eventually the accommodation will come back to normal because the accommodation excess is a secondary reaction to convergence insufficiency. So you try to work for convergence insufficiency, automatically your accommodation also will come back to normal. And one thing which you have to remember is whenever you're doing vision therapy, even if it is vergence anomaly, you'll have to always entail, the vision therapy should involve both working for accommodation and vergence. I think that answers your question, ma'am.
Nikita, Mr. Dhanaraju wants to know, apart from BIS, what are the methods to increase or decrease the difficulty in proctoring?
Okay, so if you see in proctoring cases, if the patient is having a very difficulty is too much, then what you can do is, for convergence, the relieving lenses or relieving prisms are minus lenses or basin prisms. And if you have come to the end of the therapy and you want to increase the difficulty, you can always give plus lenses binocularly. So binocularly you give plus lenses, that will increase the difficulty, or you can also give base out prisms.
Okay. Mrs. Devakani Suresh has complimented you on a great presentation.
Thank you, ma'am.
She wants to know what duration of the training and when the when to schedule a follow-up.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am, for this question, because I hadn't involved this in my therapy thing. So what happens is, the duration of therapy is, first of all, you see if the patient is willing to come for the vision therapy, because if the patient is not able to come, then you'll have to look for other options. So if you're giving vision therapy, we give it for around 7 to 10 days of around vision therapy you can give. And then you're going to put the patient on home-based therapies. So even when the patient is under home-based therapy, the patient is still under our observation. So you can call the patient for a follow-up visit for every 3 to 4 weeks. of home-based therapy. So suppose initially, for example, if I've given the home-based therapy for 3 to 4 weeks in a week, for 3 to 4 weeks or for 4 weeks, after 4 weeks, when the patient come back for a follow-up, I'll do a re-evaluation. I'll have to check what is the status of his binocular vision assessment now. So based on that, I'll have to reduce the therapy slowly. So still the patient is under my observation. So I'll be reducing the therapy to once or twice in a week. The same home-based therapy will continue. And then you can keep the patient under follow-up. Maybe after like 2 months, you can ask the patient to come back for a follow-up. So slowly you're going to reduce the therapy, making sure that the binocular vision parameters that has been improved are still maintained. So this is how we schedule our follow-ups, ma'am.
Nikita, Ms. Sukhpreet Kaur has again complimented you on a wonderful presentation.
Thank you.
And she wants to know regarding the fusional vergence dysfunction, how will you start with vision therapy?
So it is the same, ma'am. For fusional vergence dysfunction also, the mode or the protocol for the vision therapy is the same, because here also the patient's fusional amplitude is all affected. But one thing here is we have to give equal importance for both base in and base out. So whenever we give the therapy, so you'll have to see what is the diagnosis, and based on that you proceed. Like I told you, in convergence axis, we do not touch the convergence part in the beginning, at least in the beginning of the therapy. In fusional vergence dysfunction, you'll have to give equal importance to both convergence and divergence.
Okay, Dr. V.K. Rai wants to know if convergence insufficiency can be recurrent.
Yes, sir, it can be recurrent. It depends on the patient's lifestyle also. It's not only about the eye health condition or the muscle fatigue or something. It depends on the patient's lifestyle also. If the patient is continuously on near work and the patient is not having a break at all, like from the near work, then what happens, eventually the muscles will go into fatigue and the muscles are going to get affected. So you will have to maintain a good visual hygiene, I would say, for anyone. So it's not that I would not say you should never do near activity. So near activities, mobile phones, laptop has become a part of our life. But one thing is you'll have to maintain the visual hygiene, take proper breaks from near work. Don't strain your eyes so much that, you know, you by the end of the day, you get headache and only then you take a break. No, that is not a good thing. So that's all I would like to say.
So despite maintaining good visual hygiene, can it be recurrent?
Yes, sir. In some cases, yes, it can be recurrent. Would you like to add something, sir, to this question?
Would you like to differentiate between orthoptics and vision therapy here?
Yes, definitely. So if you see here in orthoptics, the orthoptics is basically working on only eye muscles. But when you see the vision therapy is not working on the eye muscles alone, but it entails a lot of things like your peripheral awareness. So what happens is when we give a lot of concentration only on improving the eye muscles, only on improving the parameters, you're giving a lot of therapies with central fusion. So what happens there is the peripheral awareness is getting dampened. So I would say that peripheral awareness is very important for me as compared to a central fusion. This peripheral awareness or peripheral fusion is something which leads to your central fusion. And when your vision therapy has worked right for a person, and if it has improved the parameters, I would say it is an everlasting cure, because peripheral awareness is not only to improve the central fusion, but it is also has an impact on several other things, several other systems, like your body balance, the anti-gravity, your vestibular system, eye movement, so many other things. If you're dampening that, then I would say that yes, convergence insufficiency can be recurrent. But when vision therapy is working on it's a holistic thing where it works on indirectly, it's working on several other systems, I think that the improvement, whatever has happened, would be an everlasting one.
So do we understand that you're talking in terms of top-down processing rather than bottom-up processing?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Mr. Devakani Suresh wants to know, what is the end point of vision therapy treatment?
So do we give up the therapy sometimes, saying cannot be improved and patient needs to live with it?
No, there's nothing like that, ma'am. So based on my experience, I have not seen any case where the vision therapy will never work for a person. See, and one more thing is that when the vision therapy is not helping a person, you will have to try giving some relieving prisms to relieve the symptoms. So that is where you will give the, you will introduce the symptom, you will introduce the prisms when the vision therapy is no more working. But the end point of vision therapy, I would say, is perfect sensory status. That is, his stereopsis has to be good, and his fusional ranges should be good. I do not care what is his fovea, if it is above or within normal limit, but I want his fusional ranges and the fusional amplitude, Virgin's amplitude, to be extremely good. So this is my endpoint. If these things are maintained, so I keep the patient under my follow-up, like for every 1 month, and then 2 months, 6 months, 1 year once. So what if I notice that the parameters are maintained, then I slowly reduce the therapy also.
Thanks, Nikita. Mr. Dhanaraju wants to know the input we need to ask the patients while giving therapy. Okay. To understand that the patient is doing it appropriately or not.
Yes, sir. Yes. Thank you, sir, for the question. So the main thing here is whenever we are giving Virgin's therapies for the patient, especially in conditions like in therapies like your tranaglyphs or vectogram, we always ask questions about feedback or feedbacks having some floating thing, that is the object, because of the 3D perception or the stereopsis effect. Is it coming in the front? Is it going behind? We term this as like Celo or Soli effect, or the localization, the float of the target. If the objects are, because of the stereopsis effect or third degree of binocular vision, is it floating, popping out in this free space? All these questions why it can be asked. Why these questions has to be asked is because, see, it's nothing to do with it indirectly has an impact on the improvement also, because kinesthetic awareness is always good. It is going to give a play a role in improving the condition, because I know that I have to converge my eyes, bring my eyes closer. I know that I should bring take my eyes apart to maintain the thing. That is not only the thing, but as an examiner, you also get an idea what is the perception of this patient. So the person sees, so it will be easy for you to understand the further therapies also, or explain the further therapies according to the patient's perception. So these are the things which you can ask from the patient, sir.
Thanks, Nikita. Mr. Navneet Sharma has complimented you on the excellent make today. He wants to know about the amount of prisms that will be prescribed and how long do you go about with these prisms?
See, when it comes to prisms, we give relieving prisms. So relieving prisms are prescribed based on certain formulas, setting certain criteria.
Me to repeat that?
Yes, sir.
Mr. Navneet Sharma wants to know the amount of prisms that you prescribe in these cases and how long do you ask the patient to continue with the prisms?
Okay. So here we are giving, I think he's talking about the relieving prisms, right, sir? Hello?
Were you able to hear me?
Yes, yes, sir. Is he talking about the relieving prisms?
Yeah, I think he's talking about the relieving prisms.
Okay, sir.
How much do you prescribe and how long do you ask the patient to continue with the relievers?
Okay. Sir, for relieving prisms, we go about with formulas like Sheard's criterion and Percival's criterion. So here, based on these formulas, we go about with prescribing the amount of prism. So based on how much amount of fovea is there and what is the compensating versions, based on that only, it has a particular formula. Sorry, I do not have it in my slide now. But based on those formulas, we prescribe the prisms for ESO and EXO. So if you see, Sheard's works well for ESO and Percival's works well for EXO conditions, exophoria conditions. So these are the things, based on these four prisms, you can give the prisms. But how long do we go about? See, relieving prisms are given for only relieving purpose, only to relieve the condition or the symptoms. Okay, so this is only a temporary relief. If the patient is not wearing the prism glasses, definitely he's going to have the symptoms. So this is only for relieving purpose. But to get rid of the problem, whatever he's having, he'll have to undergo vision therapy.
So I'll just add to that, Mr. Sharma. Mr. Divakar will be talking about how to prescribe prisms, how much to prescribe a couple of days later. So that will give you a more comprehensive idea about prisms and how to prescribe them and how long you keep them.
Nikita, you,
Mr. Karthik Pillai has complimented you on a good presentation, and he has two questions. The first one is, if VT is stopped once, the benchmark parameters is reached, or when the patient's symptom is relieved, when do you stop it?
It's not about patient's symptoms being relieved. See, if your patient's symptom has reduced, but then the parameters are still on the poorer side, yes, actually, if the when the patient visits your clinic and if the patient's parameters are poor, but the patient says, I do not have, absolutely do not have any problem, then you can think of having a vision therapy or not, or the patient should be treated or not, because the patient doesn't have any symptoms. But here the patient came with symptoms, and it's only that the symptoms are relieved or the symptoms have reduced. But when you see clinically that the parameters are still to be improved, then you can still continue the vision therapy until the parameters have improved and the parameters are maintained. So when you taper the vision therapy, you will have to see that the parameters are maintained. You will have to slowly reduce it. Do not stop it abruptly. Slowly reduce it. So suppose if the patient was doing it for 4 days in a week, reduce it to twice in a week, once in a week, and then slowly you'll have to reduce the vision therapy, sir.
The second question he wants to know is, how long will you taper the vision therapy in these anomalies?
It depends on the condition, sir. It's not the same in all the conditions. So suppose if I have a Wurgen's anomaly problem, and it took me 1 year to completely get rid of the Wurgen's anomaly, and if another person gets rid of in like 3 or 4 months, it varies. It is based on the severity of the case also, sir.
Thanks, Nikita. I think these are the questions. Do we have any more questions? Well, these are the questions that I'm seeing right now. Thank you very much for your great presentation, Nikita.
Thank you so much, sir.
So tomorrow we see you again at the same time, 12 noon, same channel. And Mr. Divakar will be talking about accommodation anomalies, how to analyze them, how to, and also to manage them. Thank you very much. Stay safe, stay happy. Thank you.